Hello guys, so today I'll be talking about primary maxillary spaces. So they are mainly three: the canine space, buccal space, and the infratemporal space. So first I'm going to cover the canine space, and before all that I'm going to talk about all the muscle attachments. We got levator labii superioris, allocnesi, levator labii superioris, zygomaticus minor, zygomaticus major, and this white one is levator labii anguli oris. We got the orbicularis oris with the lip. Here we got the buccinator, masseter, and the parotid gland. We'll talk about the canine space. Canine space boundaries include anteriorly we got the nasal cartilage, posteriorly we got the buccal space, deep is the anguli oris. And medially, there's levator labii superioris. Laterally, we've got the zygomaticus minor and major. Inferiorly, we've got the orbicularis oris muscle. So basically, the space between anguli oris and all these superior levator muscles forms the canine space. Now, if the infection from canine or premolar reaches this region, then we call it as the canine space infection. The symptoms we see is the periorbital edema, obliteration of the nasolabial floor, drooping of the corner of the mouth, and the incision given for the canine space is along the buccal mucosa. That is, it is an intraoral incision given in the buccal mucosa. So the next space we'll be talking about is the buccal space. So basically, buccal space is the space between skin and buccinator. That is the space between skin and buccinator. We call it as the buccal space. So the boundaries include the anterior border is the corner of the mouth. Posteriorly, we've got the masseter muscle. Superficial is the skin and the subcutaneous tissue. Deep, we got the buccinator. Superior, we got the maxilla. And inferior, we got the lower border of mandible. So when this space is infected, we see an extraoral swelling in this region. And the teeth commonly involved are the premolars and the molars. And so for the incision, we give a horizontal incision in the premolar and molar area intraorally. We give an intraoral horizontal incision piercing the buccinator muscle and reaching the buccal space. The third space is the infratemporal space. So in infratemporal space, there are mainly four things that we have to keep in mind. That is the pterygoid plate, the mandible, and two muscles, medial pterygoid and lateral pterygoid. So first I would like to explain the muscles. So medial pterygoid muscle has two origins. The deep head, this blue color muscle, the deep head, that is the medial surface of the lateral pterygoid plate, and a superficial head, that is the origin from the tuberosity of maxilla. And both of these heads insert on the medial surface of the angle of the mandible. So this was about the medial pterygoid muscle. Now the lateral pterygoid muscle also has two heads. Alright, so the heads are the upper head, that is from the infratemporal surface of the sphenoid bone, of the greater wing of sphenoid, and the lower head from the lateral surface of the lateral pterygoid plate, and both of these insert along the pterygoid pit of the condyle. Okay, so the infratemporal space is nothing but the space between the pterygoid plate and the mandible. So medially we got the pterygoid plate, laterally we got the mandible, superiorly we've got the base of the skull. Now, inferiorly, we've got the lateral pterygoid muscle, which comes from here to here. So, the lower border, the inferior border is formed by the lateral pterygoid muscle. And anteriorly, we've got the maxilla. And posteriorly, we've got the parotid, the deep lobe of parotid. So, if we talk about the infratemporal space from the inferior aspect of the skull, this space is the infratemporal space that is bounded medially by the pterygoid plate, laterally by the ramus. This is the superior aspect. Superiorly, we got the base of the skull, and inferiorly, we got the lateral pterygoid muscle attachment. Okay, so now I have placed the lateral pterygoid muscle, the pink color muscle, and this is the parotid gland, the superficial lobe and the deep lobe that encapsulates the mandible. So here we've got the inferior border of the infratemporal space bounded by the lateral pterygoid muscle, and the posterior border we've got the parotid gland. So the teeth commonly involved for the spread of infection in the infratemporal space are the maxillary second and third molar. The incision given is intraoral along in the buccal vestibule opposite the second and third maxillary molar, and a drain is established medial to the temporalis and medial to the coronoid process. Another interesting fact about the infratemporal surface is that it is connected superiorly to the temporal space and inferiorly to the pterygomandibular space. So we got the temporal space, the infratemporal space, and the pterygomandibular space, all three connected.